Let's pray. Barukatar unai lohenu melekha olayim, ashakichanu bimatsotak vitsvanu, darshok bidevri Torah. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who sanctifies us with his commands and commanded us to engross ourselves in the words of the Torah. Amen. Amen. We've studied three churches, right? We are at the turning point in the church age. We had the church of Ephesus, which was very Jewish, very Hebrew in its scripture foundation. The next church was the church of Smyrna, which was the persecuted church because they believed in the word of God, but they were persecuted from every angle, from a social and a religious point of view, because of the Jews. Because of the Jews. The main perpetrators were the Jews. Right? As I said, it's a tragedy which has lasted to this date. Most Jews don't believe that Yeshua is the Messiah. I was reading a blog recently where one Jew from New York says, how can a bastard be the Messiah? That particular blog hurt me more than anything else. But this is what Rav Shaul in Romans 11 has said, right? That blindness has come to the Jews. Blindness. See, Judaism has actually accelerated from the period of AD 90, post-temple, right? They are more into the Talmud and the Mishnah than into the Tanakh, and that's their problem. They're more into the Talmud and the Mishnah, and that's the problem. The Talmud and Mishnah are not inspired. They're not inspired. There's no way. Right? There's no Ruach Elohim in that. There's no Ruach Elohim. So, we who are blessed to see both sides of it, the Brit Hadashat as well as the Tanakh, A, must not be alarmed, because Rav Shaul in Romans 11 clearly says that partial blindness has fallen upon the Jews who are not saved as yet. But they will be saved. He says all Israel will be saved. So we pray for the peace of Jerusalem. We pray for all the Jews who are in spiritual blindness, that the Mashiach, through the Ruach Elohim, will open that blindness. So Smyrna went through a lot of persecution. They became very poor. But actually, the Lord says it's the richest church. So if you take the seven churches, it's like in an anti-clockwise cycle. Right? So it starts with Ephesus, it goes in clockwise. Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, the church that got married and sold itself as the harlot. Pergamos is the harlot church. It sold everything of the spirit to the sukkas in Greek, the soul. It is the most soulish church in the whole of the seven churches. Totally married to the world. And it is the church where the Lord said, you have a wordless church. There is no word in that church. Right? Now we come to Thyatira. Thyatira. It was a wealthy town in the northern part of Lydia, right? Of Rome and province of Asia, on the river Lysus. It stood so near to the borders of Mysia that some of the early writers have regarded it as belonging to the country. Its early history is not well known, but it was refounded by Seleucus Nectar. Now, Seleucus Nectar comes from one of the four generals, the lineage of the Seleucids, who took over the part of Syria, right? In 301 to 281 BC. It was a small, insignificant place, and it stood between Pergamos and Sardis, and it derived its wealth from Lysias, which became a commercial center but never a metropolis. The name Thyatira comes from the castle of Thya, T-H-Y-A. There was a castle of Thya, that's why it's called Thyatira, right? The castle of Thya. Other names are born out of it, which are Philopia and Semiramis. Amazingly, it was called Semiramis at one stage. Yeah, amazing. You know, why I say seven armies? Because you will find, as we study, that this church is the only church that tolerated a false prophetess. Amazing. See, the Lord says, I know the end from the beginning. Mm. These names were given pagan names, prophesizing from a pagan perspective of what they would be. The first form of false worship came out of Semiramis, who was the mother and the wife of Nimrod in Babylon. Right? And it's amazing that Thyatira takes this name. Upon the early coins of Thyatira, the ascetic god is represented as a horseman wearing a double-headed battle axe, similar to those represented in the sculptures of the Hittites. A goddess associated with him was called Boretien, the deity of less importance. Another temple at Thyatira was dedicated to Sambati, and the shrine was that of a prophetess. Can you see how it's moving? All these signs were leading up to a physical... See, that's what we have to understand. Ephesians 6 says we don't wrestle against flesh and blood. There is an angelos, a messenger from God to Daniel. He says for 21 days, Daniel was asked to fast. Right? And he says for 21 days, I was battling with the prince of Persia, a spirit. But he says on my return, I have to fight the prince of Greece. The prince of Greece, the actual nation, was coming 300 years later. But there was this principality already there. Here in Thyatira, there was the spirit of Semiramis, right? The spirit of Sambalin, right? Who was revered as a false prophetess. Can you see? And eventually, right, it supposed to represent Jezebel of Revelation 2:20. Amazing. Because Yeshua, when he's talking to Yohanan, he says, you have and tolerate that prophetess Jezebel. And she calls herself a prophetess. You understand? Can you see? There's nothing new under the sun. It's all falling into a beautiful pattern. Thyatira was specially noted for its trade guilds, which probably more completely organized than any other ancient city. Every artisan belonged to a guild, and every guild, which was incorporated into the organization, possessed property of its own name, made contracts for greater constructions, and wielded a wide influence. Powerful among them was the guild of coppersmiths. Another was the guild of dyers. They were very good in dyeing cloth. And it is from this guild that Lydia, in the book of Acts, comes out of. See, everything connects. Acts 16, 14. She sold her dyes in Philippi. Right? Lydia. The color obtained by the users of this dye is now called Turkish red. The guilds were closely connected with the Asiatic region of the place. Pagan feasts had a lot of prominence there, with immoral practices associated with it, and were held, therefore, the nature of the guilds was such that they were totally opposed to Christianity. There was a lot of spiritual fornication. When you say that, you must understand that there is a spirit of spiritual fornication. Then comes the physical fornication. And as we study about the accusations to the church of Thyatira, you will find that that's exactly the case. According to Acts 19:10, Rav Shaul may have preached there while he was living in Ephesus, but it is uncertain. Yet, Christianity reached an early stage there, and it was taught by many of the early church that no Christian might belong to one of the guilds, because all the guilds had incorporated paganism, Pergamos, right? Every guild. The church of Thyatira is the fourth of seven churches addressed in Revelation chapters 2 and 3. It corresponds to the fourth of the seven kingdom parables told by our Lord in Matthew 13, as we looked at last time. Many Christians will ask the question, does the church of Thyatira exist today? And I would say a big yes. A big yes. Not only does this church exist, but it is the easiest and most readily identifiable church
in the churches today. It's amazing. Thyatira in the world has its stroboscopes on. It's flashing and saying, I'm here. This has not only been true throughout church history, but at the present time we shall see that there's no other church that the book of Revelation points to as this church. Matthew 13:33, another parable he spoke to them. The kingdom of heaven is like leaven. Wow. The kingdom of heaven is like sin. Where is the kingdom of heaven? On this earth. Thy kingdom come. It has come and it's like leaven. Amazing, isn't it? When you see the parallel parables. He said the kingdom of heaven is like leaven, which a woman. This is the only out of the seven parables, there's a woman, a false prophetess, who took it and hid in it 3 measures till all was leavened. To a Jew, when you talk of leaven or leaven, and you talk of 3 measures, you are jumping into Genesis 18, where Elohim, the Creator God, came to the tent, right, by the oaks of Mamre, where Abraham was resting. You understand? And he gets Sarah to take 3 measures of meal, which is called the fellowship meal. There's no other passage in the Torah that tells you about the fellowship meal. It's the first place. And that's what Matthew 13 is tying up. Now, to the majority of the Western church, they are clueless about the fellowship meal, and they are clueless with Matthew 13 and the book of Revelation. 7 parables, 7 churches, and 7 epistles written by Rav Shaul. It's amazing how they merge. All Torah is God-breathed. All Torah is God-breathed. And Torah does not mean law, it means the inspired word of God. Right? We have already addressed the issue of leaven in other biblical topical studies relating to spiritual adultery and spiritual fornication. And that is what this woman is introducing. Fornication and adultery are mentioned in this passage of a spiritual nature, not of a physical. Why? Things happen in the spirit first, then they happen in the physical. The church of Thyatira was vibrant and growing. But our Lord issues both a commendation and a rebuke to his children. And let's look at his remarks. And to the angelos of the church of, or the assembly of Thyatira, write. These says the Lord, who has eyes of a flame of fire and his feet like burnished brass. What does this represent? This represents a God who is walking in judgment of this church. He is saying that this is the God of Revelation 19 who is coming down to judge the heavens and the earth. He's coming down. His eyes are like flaming fire, which means it looks through everything, it burns through everything, and it cleanses everything as he walks. He comes as a figure of the burning bush, the egoimi, the I am. Or in Hebrew, what they say, the Yeh Asher Yeh, I am that I am that I am. That is what Moses or Moshe encountered, the God of judgment, but also the God of mercy. Why? At Mount Sinai, he came down as a God who heard the cries of my people. 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, right, and turn from their wicked ways, then I will be their God, they will be my people, and I will take the iniquity and the curse away from the land. Same God. We are saved by Yeshua, the Son of Man, when we believe in him as the Savior of our souls, who became perfect, the perfect sacrifice for our sins through his death, burial, and glorious resurrection. I want to stop here and tell you something. What we call Christianity, to me, is a disaster. Because when somebody says they are a Christian, You don't know what sort of a monkey, and when I say a monkey, I'm not saying in the hideous form, but monkeys jump from one tree to another. Monkeys never stick to plantain trees. He'll be on a papaw tree today, he'll be on a guava tree tomorrow. He's a monkey, he's jumping all over the place. And Christians represent that. You come out of the Roman Catholic Church, you jump into a charismatic church. From a charismatic church, you go into some other church. You're like jumping. What is the Torah in your life? The inspired word of God as a foundation. Three things. If these three things are not in you, you shall not rise and cheat the second death. Very clear. Let me say this again. If these three things are not in your spirit, you are not born of the Spirit. That Yeshua came as God, but died as man for our sins. Because the penalty is not God against God, it's God against man. So he had to die as man. According to Isaiah 53 and Psalm 22. The mouth of two witnesses. Deuteronomy 18. The second thing is that in his death, right, there was a burial. The dying of the old man and the resurrection of the new man. If those three things are not in your spirit, you're not born of the Father. He came as a man because according to the book of Leviticus, cursed is he who hangs on a tree. So he had to hang on a tree. Like he said, when you see the son of Jonah, he had to be in the grave 3 days and three nights. The burial. And he said to the Pharisees, destroy this temple, not that temple. And I shall resurrect it in 3 days and three nights. Amazing, isn't it? And that's exactly what he did. He resurrected this temple, the temple of the living God, in spirit, so that one day those who believe, you will rise like Christ. Amen? That's the purpose. That's our belief. Never mind about everything else. Some worship on Sunday, we worship on the Shabbat. Right? Some people have a pagan Good Friday and a pagan Christmas. We go by the Moedim according to Leviticus 23. All those are there. The three essential things. Did he come as the Son of Man? Did he die for your sins? Was he buried? Did he rise again? If those three are there, you're saved. If you believe in that. Amen? How many are learning that for the first time? Gosh, it's amazing, isn't it? What you don't learn in church. Three essentials, right? That is from the author of eternal life. But now even more, through the scriptures we recognize that he is now Emmanuel, God with us. That's amazing. He is with us. How is he with us? Through the Ruach Elohim, the Spirit of the living God. I am going and I will send you a comforter, the Ruach Elohim. He knows all things, for he is the Spirit of truth. That's why in Matthew 28 he says, I will be with you always. He is Emmanuel according to Isaiah. Right? It's a pity that the Jew can read Isaiah and not see the Mashiach. Amazing. Sad. Pray for them. Yeshua, the Son of God, is officiating on our behalf, as I taught you this earlier, as the Kohen HaGadol, the high priest in heaven. That's why he's standing by the lampstand, interceding for us. You know, in the English Bibles, he kills it. I saw Jesus standing by seven candlesticks. Why? The candle maker. The butcher, the baker, and the candlestick maker all went out to see. This is good for Winston Churchill and the Queen of England. It's not good for me. Oh, so you know, old chap, you know, that was Jesus standing probably with a mug of mirror, you know. The trees. This is nonsense. The God we worship is Jewish. He's a Hebrew God. He's the God of Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov. He's not the God of George Bush, or Barack Obama, or whatever. He is a Hebrew God. He will come back as a Hebrew God. I'm serious. That's why he's taking away the Christians, because they will get the shock of their lives when they see the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob coming with a tzitzit covered with his head, and the name Melech Melechaim Adon Adon on his thigh, because he'll be riding a white horse. I was listening to a rabbi who's known Messiah, and he says, why are we worried about Islamic eschatology? He said, it's false. Whether there's a Mahdi or not, we don't care. We know it's not true. He says, you know, they're talking about the 12th Imam and the 12th. He says, don't worry about it. It's not going to happen. He says, some Christians are trying to say he is the same as the Antichrist. He said, it doesn't matter. He says, whether it's the 12th Imam or it's the Antichrist, he ends up in hell, so who cares? What we should care is that Melech Melechaim Adon Adon, Yeshua HaMashiach, he's the one that reigns for 1,000 years on this earth, and then new heavens, new earth. Amazing, amazing. The message to the church is from Yeshua our Lord. The features and aspects of our Lord is that in focus here of one of judgment. He's here to judge this church. Why? Because he loves it. It's not going to be a pretty picture when God judges, because it hurts, it pains, right? The appearance of our Lord before his church is with eyes like flame of fire and his feet like fine brass, which is a picture of our Lord ready to judge. The problem is that the Roman Catholics are still worshipping a baby in a manger in Bethlehem. Then some of them have taken him and made him the baby out of Poland, infant Jesus, with osteoporosis. You can't see his neck because they put a collar on it, and this huge thing, and they're worshipping him. I'm sorry, that's not God. Others, every time you go to church, you have to take some infalac or some baby milk and go. Yeah, that's the perception. I had an argument with this woman from India while I was teaching on the tour in Israel. And finally, you know, I broke down every argument of hers. I mean, talking to a Catholic is so easy. For a Torah teacher to break down Catholicism is so easy. And finally she said, I agree with everything you're saying. But isn't he sweet in his baby form? I turned to my wife and I said, I'm going to jump out of this coach. This will be the first guide on an Israeli tour that's committing harakiri because of a Catholic. I said, madam, he sitteth at the right hand of the Father. And I said, his eyes are like flaming fire. I was quoting the church of Thyatira. I said, his feet are like burnished brass. He is a God of judgment. And she said, really? I said, read the book of Revelation. She said, no, I prefer to him as an infant. I'll tell you why. Because an infant, you can turn the fellow and shake the fellow any way you want. You can't do that with Yeshua HaMashiach. You get the point. A baby, you can plug anything into his mouth and he'll drink it. It's nice. You can't do that with God. That's the difference. He is not meek and mild. It is not our desire to see the Lord approach us in this manner of judgment. It's frightening. But remember this, that even at the time of Moshe, when he came down to judge as well as to discipline for those he loved. That's why he had a mercy seat. See, the Christians, they don't seem to get this. They're also partially blind. Oh, the Jews were condemned. The Jews have been replaced by the church. Heresy. Absolute heresy. Any church, I don't care whom their pastor is and what doctorate he has got, if any church is not praying for the blinded Jew who has not accepted the Mashiach, if they are not praying for the wisdom of Yahweh Elohim, for Benjamin Netanyahu at the most crucial period in history, if they are not praying Psalm 122, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. They are not a church that believes in the Messiah. I'm sorry. If they teach replacement theology, they have joined the camp of the Islamists who want to replace Israel with Islam, and the church wants to replace the Jews with Christianity. I'm sorry, it doesn't work. Same God. I am that I am that I am. Yesh Asher Kehe. I am that I am that I am. You can't change that. And that's what they're trying to do. Make no mistakes. He is more than capable and willing to judge his people and necessary for the church of Thyatira. 1 Corinthians 11:32. But when we are judged, we are chastised by the Lord, that we may not be condemned with the world. Whom he loves, he chastises. 1 Corinthians 11:32. James 5:9. And here is, his name is Yaakov. He's the blood brother of Yeshua. Right? The Roman Catholic Church says that he didn't have brothers. He had brothers and two sisters. Read the Gospels, you'll find it out. He says, do not, by the way, he headed the council of Jerusalem in Acts chapter 15 and not Kepha, Peter. So Peter could not have been the first pope. If you read Acts 15 to a Catholic, they will be shocked that the rock that he spoke about, on this rock I shall build my church, he's the rock. He's the rock. Read the Psalms, read the book of Deuteronomy. He says, I am Yahweh, I am the rock, there is no other. And when he says, I will build my rock, I will build my church on this rock, he's talking about himself, not Peter. And here is Yaakov, or James as the British call him. Do not grumble against one another, brethren, lest you be condemned. Behold, the judge is standing at the door. That's why he says, I am the door. I am the door. 1 Peter 4:17. For the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God. How amazing. How amazing. I'm reading this and I'm teaching you this in August 2012. And it's so apt because the church in Sri Lanka is running towards signs and wonders. You can't have somebody who says, we have somebody who has come from abroad. We have somebody who has come from abroad, and you have to buy a bottle of 500 rupee oil, or you have this or that. You know, you don't need anybody from abroad. Because our message, this message is intergalactic. This is an outside message coming into this world. This is coming through hyperdimensions. Right? But no, if the moment somebody is from another country, that's why Yeshua says a prophet is not accepted in his own nation. Simple. 1 Peter 4:17. For the time has come for the judgment to begin at the house of God, Bethel. And if it begins with us first, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of Jesus Christ? In short, he's saying, whom he loves, he rebukes. Whom he loves, he rebukes. And if his rebuke is too strong for you, how much more for those who have rejected him? If his rebuke is strong for those who know him, how much more for those who hate him? Are we learning something here this morning? Praise God. His eyes are like a flame of fire. Also speaks of judgment. Revelation 19. Now I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. And he who sat on it was called faithful and true. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. When he first came, he said, I have not come for peace. I come for war. Father against mother, brother against sister. You understand? Unless you are willing to leave everything and follow him, you will not be at peace. You will be at war. You will be at war. He judges and makes war. His eyes was like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written which no one except him knew. His feet were like fine brass, right? Which also speaks of judgment. So I'm giving you the parallel of the church of Thyatira, of the same God who appears to Yohanan and speaks about the church of Thyatira as that of the God who is returning to judge the whole world. Same God, same form of judgment, same physical appearance. Psalms 58:10. The righteous shall rejoice when he sees the vengeance, he shall wash his feet in the blood of the wicked. That is why Yeshua says, I have trodden the winepress. I. Not the church, not the angels in heaven, I. He trods the winepress. 1 Corinthians 15:25. For he must reign till he has put his enemies, all his enemies, under his feet. And it's going to happen. It's going to happen. It's happening sooner than we think. Take a picture of the Middle East. A few days ago, it was reported in Cairo that all the Christians have been told to get out of Egypt by the Muslims. How strange. They say that Yeshua is a prophet. Prophet means he came from God. If he came from God, why do you want to persecute his people? Oxymoron, isn't it? Every Christian that they put the sword of Allah to, they will burn in hell forever and forever and forever. The eyes of the Lord move to and fro over all the earth. Verse 19, I know your works. Again, any church including this synagogue, everything we do, everything we say, everybody whom we receive, he says, I know your works. It is true that there are people who have come here, who have gone out and insulted us, but when they come back, we receive them with open arms, with the same love that we greet each one of you. Because if you are not doing that, we are not doing his work. It's tough, it's hard. But that's what he says, love your enemies. It's amazing. I know your works, your love, your agape, your service, your faith. And again, what he told the church in Ephesus, the patience. Right? And as far as your works, the last are more than the first. Right? He's saying, I like the patience and all that. The attributes of this church are listed in a descending order. The works of this church are condemned and foremost in his address to them. Their works are increasing. And he's saying, hey, that's the problem. Titus 2:7. In all things, showing yourself to be a pattern of good works in doctrine, showing integrity, reverence, incorruptibility. There's no point going and evangelizing the whole world if your scriptural knowledge, your foundation, there's no integrity in the doctrine, there's no reverence, and there's no incorruptibility. The moment your doctrine is corrupt, everything else will start breaking off. Because you're breaking up the word of God, you're diluting the word of God. And that's what the church of Pergamos did, and it became the wordless church. Titus 2:14, he who gave himself up for us, that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good works. Christ redeemed all of us for good works. He didn't save us so that, like old ladies, we can come on a Sunday morning with brim hats and look so nice and posh and smell of powder and perfume and go back 1 hour later. He saved us from the pit and cleansed us to go out and do good works. And the first good works that Christians have to do is to teach other Christians the incorruptible word of God. As you found out a few hours earlier and a few days ago, that even Abraham went on Noah's Ark. You know, you find this out. That was a slip of the system of thinking, nothing else. It was not that he did not know scripture. But I'm telling you, if you tell them that Enoch was also on Noah's Ark, they'll believe it. Because it is the Old Testament. The Old Testament. A lady who called me a few days ago had a 1.5 hour conversation over the phone with me. And when I started telling her about the millennium rule with the Mashiach and the Jewish nation, she was like, is it there? I said, yes, providing you have a Bible. But isn't that the Old Testament? I said, no, it is new. It is what the French drink every new season called the Beaujolais Nouveau, the new wine, the Beaujolais. I said, the book of Isaiah, the book of Ezekiel, the book of Zechariah are more new than the New Testament. I said, the New Testament is actually old because they are quoting from the Tanakh. I said, the book of Hazon, the book of Revelation has 404 passages out of the Tanakh. So I said, how old is the Tanakh then? He was talking about the fusion. No, but then that's what we were taught. That's the problem. First learn to evangelize the Christians. Because they are walking around like zombies. They worship a Jesus with a three-piece suit and American accent. And they have a Holy Ghost, whose brother must be Casper. We worship Ruach Elohim, the spirit, and I'm saying this with absolute, absolute reverence. I don't worship ghosts. They are demons. We worship Ruach Elohim, the spirit of the living God. And it's all these American preachers who say, oh, the Holy Ghost told me. A child looking at a comic thinks that's Casper's brother. Casper the friendly ghost. There are no ghosts in the Bible. He's the spirit of the living God. And when you refer to him with the same, the kadosh, the same sacredness as you approach the Father. He is holy, he's kadosh, he's to be worshipped, he's to be revered, he's to be honored. He says, I do not change in the book of Mike, in the book of Malachi. I do not change. So how come he's the Ruach Elohim, the spirit, the breath of God, and suddenly he's a ghost? Ghosts are things that freak you out. You go to Disneyland and you go into a place where you see ghosts, holograms, and they are leaving that to God. I'm sorry. Wrong. He's the Ruach Elohim. Unfortunately, their love, service, faith, and patience are pale by comparison. The attribute of patience is completely lacking in the church. And what are they looking at? Seeking for signs, wonders, miracle. That is fornication. That is fornication. Today, while we were worshipping God, God said, stop, go next door, invite that lady, bring her here, pray for her. And if you saw all the worship songs, it was about hearing one's prayer. Isn't it amazing? That's our God. That's a sign. That's a miracle. But there's no gold dust falling from the air. You know, there's no strange, weird things happening. If gold dust should have fallen, it should have fallen when Yeshua fulfilled Zechariah 9:9. Here, Jerusalem, comes your king. The Melech Melechayim, the King of Kings. There was no gold dust. People cut palms, people threw their cloaks, and they welcomed the king. There was no gold dust. If gold dust should have fallen at the transfiguration on Mount Hermon, gold dust should have fell. When the angels announced and the Parthians came across, gold dust should have fallen because it has to do with reverence to the king. I wonder from where this gold dust is falling. And people are running. Why does gold dust falling? People are getting gold teeth. Nobody's got a gold tongue, then they'll shut their mouths up once and for all. The tongue won't wag. No, really. This is the church of Thyatira. That's why I said, just look out of your window and you see the church of Thyatira. Oh, a church full of prophecy, signs and wonders. Hey, what's so new? It happened from the time of the book of Acts. If you're worshipping in a place where the Holy Spirit is there, it's normal. People have come here and demons have said, oh boy, this place is too hot for us. Out. Words of knowledge have come. Today Sudarshan, the moment we prayed for this lady, he got a word of knowledge. Signs and wonders. And nothing. You know, it's normal. But these people have created a doctrine of demons by saying, we are specializing in signs and wonders. Wrong. You understand? See, to me, I don't get excited, I get very perturbed. Mark 16 says, you shall cast out demons. Whom? The pastor? The bishop? The deacon? All. So what's new, pussycat? What's new? As our black brother will say, yo man, what's new? Nothing. There's nothing new under the sun. Yeshua said, the clear sign of your salvation is you shall lay hands and cast out demons. You shall speak utterances in tongues. If you drink something that's poison, it will not harm you. You shall lay hands and people will get healed. You shall prophesy. So what's the problem? What's this uniqueness about one or two churches? You see, that's where the false doctrine is. And that's what Thyatira is about. The seeking after has to do with desiring the glory of God before His appointed time. He will reveal His glory to us when He comes, but not now. 1 Thessalonians 4. For this is the will of God, your sanctification, that you should abstain from sexual immorality, fornication, that each one of you should know how to possess his own vessel and sanctification and honor, not in the passion of lust, seeking for signs. It said so. Like the Gentiles who do not know God. He's talking to the church of Thessalonica and saying, don't do these things. Right? That's okay, that was in Thessalonica, not in the world today. That no one should take advantage or and defraud his brother in this matter, because the Lord is an avenger of all such, and we also have forewarned you and testified. It's very clear. Today there are people moving mass exodus from one church to another, because suddenly there's this new pastor who has words of knowledge and signs and wonders. So this other place dies. Can't be God, can it? Can't be God. I mean, he says, I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever. But that's happening. Can you see the church of Thyatira more prevalent in the world today? Am I correct? For God did not call us to uncleanliness, fornication, but kadosh, holiness. Therefore, he who rejects this does not reject man, but God, and who has also given him the Holy Spirit, the Ruah Elohim. See, when you reject the things from the Word of God, you're rejecting God, you're rejecting His Holy Spirit, because He is the Spirit of Truth. Rav Shaul is saying, first, that we are not to commit fornication, period, period. The door closes. He's also saying that for a Christian, to encourage a fellow Christian to participate in fornication is to defraud him, because he's his brother. And you know something, where this defrauding comes in? Through the Word. When you take a word and you say, it doesn't mean this, it means this, when actually it means something totally different, you're defrauding your brother. That is spiritual fornication. That is spiritual fornication. To practice fornication is in complete rejection of the Holy Spirit, because the work attributed to the Holy Spirit is done in hypocrisy and not is the will of the Holy Spirit. And that's happening today. Nevertheless, I have these things against you. Verse 20. Because you allow that woman, Jezebel. Now, if you look at that name in Hebrew and in the Greek, you will find that it means daughter of Baal or Baal. Daughter of Baal or Baal. Right? Who calls herself a prophetess. Who calls her a prophetess? The church? No, she calls herself. What is she doing? She's walking into a place, an assembly, where people are worshipping God. And that's why in the last days, the Word of God says, ravenous wolves have already entered the church. Ravenous wolves. My job is to discern who comes in here and what their agendas are. You see, you can't just have somebody coming in here and saying, I'm a prophetess. You have to really search the scriptures and find out, is this person under an anointing? So this woman was actually coming and fornicating in the church. This is an Old Testament character, right, has been warned not to teach or have authority. Women have been told in scripture they can't take authority over a church. They can't head a church. They can't head and say, I'm in charge of this group. It's scriptural. I mean, it's not my words, it's the words of Rav Shaul. For this reason, it is because their natural tendency to deception. And I'm not saying this to any woman in particular. That's the biblical concept, that woman was the cause of deception. Therefore, to this date, she's not supposed to hold an anointed office in a church. She can be a part of a committee or whatever. She can't be the pastor. Sorry. She can't be the spiritual leader. I'm only quoting scripture. Right? Because when you study the Bible, you will find that there are topical studies which covers this about women in ministry. Very, very careful. You know, I was reading 1 Timothy 5, and Rav Shaul says, you know, for a woman who's a young widow, don't come and say, you know, I want to dedicate my life to the church. Because still there's that tendency, I want to get married. He says, listen, don't dishonor God, go and get married. Look for a good husband. Because woman is more, I said, now please don't argue with me and say, men are more open to deception. I'm just quoting the word of God. And that's why anointed offices are not given to women. So, you have a problem, you take it up with the Lord. The woman Jezebel does not represent some abstract nature of wickedness or sin, but it's a specific reference to the work of deception. That's what I'm trying to tell you. See, we are there to encourage and bring you back into the fold through the word of God by the power of Ruach Elohim. Nothing else. The woman in the parable in Matthew 13 is the only person who can fit in. The only parable that can fit into this is the woman hiding leaven in the fellowship meal. Why? Fellowship is the assembly. She's taking sin and hide. It says she hid it. She hid it in the fellowship meal. She introduced it through deception. You see that? See, when you... How many people have seen this for the first time? Yeah, it's amazing. People read Matthew 13, now Matthew 13, separate, Old Testament. Then they read the Revelation 7 churches, separate. No, it's all connected. Let's read on. The fact that he names Jezebel and refers to the Old Testament account of Ahab and Jezebel is that she was a wicked woman and sought the life of Elijah as well as the other prophets. And that's exactly what this woman Jezebel is doing in the church of Thyatira. Her objective, among other things, was to destroy God's people. And this prophetess, who was sent by God to instruct and to teach Israel, had an opponent, Jezebel, daughter of Baal. She even killed other God-fearing Jews, including the vineyard owner Naboth, who had an inheritance that came from his genealogy, his lineage. It is noted in other Bible topical studies, the seekings of signs and wonders and miracles is actually fornication. Spiritual fornication acts as leaven, propagates by the doctrine of deception. The fact that she calls herself a prophetess refers to the fact that she claims to speak for God. To commit sexual immorality should be translated as fornication. We already know from previous studies that fornication referred to here is spiritual fornication. Spiritual fornication is the belief, the promotion, and the practice of signs and wonders and miracles in the church by a believer, parallel in comparison to spiritual adultery, belief, promotion, or practices of signs and wonders in a church by an unbeliever. It's an exact parallel. Eat the things offered to idols is a reference to corrupting the word of God. See, we have this concept, especially coming from an Asian country, because there are more pagans putting food in front of statues and coming offering it to you, that that's adultery. No. It is taking the word of God and misinterpreting it and giving people the wrong interpretation. The reference to Jezebel as a prophet denotes the fact that she is a dominant factor in the church, teaching with force, and is proclaiming and teaching that the word of God coming out of her is actually leading to spiritual fornication. Her method of doing this is by teaching and committing fornication based on hypocrisy, and her goal is to destroy. John 10:10, the thief comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. She's corrupting the word of God by teaching that the word of God advocates, teaches, and encourages Christians to seek after signs and wonders. Wrong. The word of God does not encourage you to seek after signs and wonders and miracles. The practicing and the standing on the word of God results in signs, wonders, and miracles. You see the difference? You don't run after it. You stand on the word of God and you rebuke that disease in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, and the signs and wonders takes place. What is your standing? On the word of God. She's saying that the word of God, this is like that church I preached to in Moratuwa. It says, I gave you the tithe, now Lord, give me back $1 million. Doesn't work like that, does it? Sadly. 1 Corinthians 5:6, your glorifying is not good. You do not know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump. From the word of God. If we back up a bit, we notice that the apostle Shaul is charging the church at Corinth with the same spiritual fornication. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. It is actually reported there is sexual immorality, fornication among you, such sexual immorality, fornication, as is not even named among the Gentiles, that man has his father's wife. In short, it's as equivalent as a son going and sharing his father's bed. Which is what Reuben did. Right? Actually, the issue of fornication goes all the way back to the book of Bereshit, where Ham had a sexual connection with Noah. It says because Noah, when he got up, knew that Ham had done something and he cursed him. Right? Who uncovered his father's nakedness. He just didn't come and lift his father's nakedness. He did something. If you read a lot of the studies from the different rabbis, you will find that it alludes to some act of homosexuality. Okay? If we continue on the book of Corinthians, we believe we find a remedy to eliminate fornication in the church as follows. In the name of our Lord Yeshua HaMashiach, when you are gathered together along with my spirit, not with my ghost, with the power of the Lord Yeshua HaMashiach, deliver such one to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, that his spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord. In short, if you find that somebody is into spiritual fornication or sexual fornication, the word of God is saying send him that way, but pray that his spirit will get saved. That his addiction will rest in the flesh, but that the spirit, it's straight from scripture. Since fornication has to do with signs, wonders, and miracles, this instruction by Rav Shaul was quite remarkable, seeing that the apostles were alive at that particular time and were able to perform miracles, signs. Yeah, it's not that he was preaching against Peter and James and all that. He's saying, stand on the word of God, and signs and wonders will take place. In addition to leaven, we'll continue from the apostles from John's day until the complete church age, and the church of Thyatira is completely leavened. According to this, that's what's happening to the world today. The leaven is actually expanding. The birds of the air fill the mustard tree, right? All into spiritual fornication. Lastly, he says, I gave her time to repent from her sexual immorality, and she did not repent. It confirms that the woman is Jezebel and is a believer, but she will not repent. That's what I call iniquity. That's what I call iniquity. She's not called upon in the name of Yeshua by faith, but to stop her sexual fornication. If she were a believer, this would make no sense. An unbeliever sees the free practice and doctrine suits their fancy, but Christians are asked to avoid certain things. This confirms the fact that spiritual fornication pertains to believers as opposed to spiritual adultery, which is aimed at unbelievers. In the church perspective, Yeshua is making a continuous appeal to members of the assembly to repent of spiritual fornication. Repent. In short, in the Hebrew calendar, there is a period called Yom Tehura, the 40 days of turning back. That's what it parallels. Unfortunately, it is sensual and it is not spiritual. Jude talks about spiritual adulteress in his book.
Jude 19, these adulterers are sensual persons who cause divisions, not having the Ruach Elohim. As I said, you can look at scripture, it will expound and expound and expound where they are going wrong. Indeed, verse 22, indeed I will cast her into a sick bed, and those who commit adultery with her into the great tribulation, unless they repent of their deeds. Now here, what you must understand is, a sick bed has to do with the fellowship meal again. When you sit at a table in the times of the Lord, you recline and eat, because now you are free. But the leaven has come and it corrupts. And it's saying that that whole assembly that's reclining to eat the fellowship meal will actually be corrupted. It will be turned into a bed of adultery. That's what it's talking about. And unbelievers occurs in every church, as was told by the Lord in the parable of the wheat and the tares. So he's saying, if you continue like this, like the parable of the wheat and the tares, one day he shall separate one from the other. Her fornication or practice of signs and wonders and miracles will not only attract future believers in Christ, but it will attract unbelievers as well. The unbelievers will join the church and also practice the same type of fornication. However, the fact that they are unbelievers points to the fact that they are adulterers and not fornicators. The interaction between believers and these groups is of concern, because one can pollute the other. The Great Tribulation has dual meaning. First, it is in direct reference to the Great Tribulation, right? The days of war, which most Christians are awake that it takes place at the end of this age after the rapture. The church is at the end time right now, and in that sense it becomes highly visible with the characteristics of fornication in its nature. Just before the Great Tribulation, the church, the lump, will be completely leavened, which is very, very frightening. It's saying that as we get closer to the rapture, more and more churches are going to be in spiritual fornication, which is exactly parallel to the birds of the air filling the mustard tree. Matthew 24:21, for there will be great tribulation, such has not been since the beginning of the world until this time, nor there shall ever be. Secondly, the Great Tribulation is a reference to the salvation status of those unbelievers who are committing adultery. These folk will undergo the Great Tribulation of eternal death. These adulterers will be lost and they'll be unsaved. Romans 2:5, but in accordance with your hardness and your impotent heart, you are treasuring up for yourself the wrath in the day of wrath and revelation of righteousness in the judgment of God, who will render each one according to his deeds. So as I said, you know, I have given you a lot of scripture, a lot of backing. Eternal life to those who are by patient continuance in doing good and seeking glory and honor for immortality. But to those who are self-seeking and who do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation and wrath, tribulation and anguish on every soul of man who does evil, of the Jew first and also the Greek, but the glory, honor and peace to everyone whose works is that's good, the Jew first and also the Greek, the one new man. So as I said, be careful, because we are in this day. We are talking about a time of tribulation, which is eternal death to those who are not saved. Verse 23, I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he who searches the minds and hearts. I will be given to each one of you according to your works. This, the children referred to are not born again, but children who are illegitimate children, those who are practicing adultery by the side of the church, and God who's watching them and saying, listen, you are destined for destruction. So as I said, understand that we are moving in a time where this church of Thyatira is really, really prevalent and present in our day. And we should be very careful to figure out that we do not fall into that sick bed, but fall into the bed of fellowship. Because the Lord says, I shall not drink of this cup of the wine until I drink it with you. He's talking about the fellowship again. Where did he do it? At the table of fellowship, the Last Supper. Amen? I hope we've learned something today. Yeah, let's pray. Father, I just give you thanks, I give you praise. I thank you, Lord, that although the church of Thyatira
is nearing its completion state, being fully leveled. Lord, you have said, hold fast till I come. Your final verse 25 is, hold fast till I come. Lord, it is my prayer today that we who are small in stature are strong and great in spirit and in your word. And I pray, Lord, for this Kahilia, this assembly, this called out people, that we may hold fast till you come and say, Maranatha, come Lord Yeshua, come. Father, this is how you instructed Aaron to bless the children. Ivarekaka Adonai Vishmareka, E Adonai Panivileka Vihunuleka, Isa Adonai Panivileka Vyashemleka Shalom. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance and give you his shalom. Go in the peace of the Lord. Amen. To the Lord.